invite you this morning to the book of 1 Corinthians, chapter number 15. It's the longest chapter in the Bible about the next life. The subject matter of 1 Corinthians chapter 15 is the resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ. And as we have come to celebrate Easter Sunday today, I want to speak to you on that subject. Christianity is the only faith, religion, though we don't use that word for us, on planet Earth, of the hundreds and hundreds that are, that has a living founder. Our founder, the Lord Jesus Christ, 2,000 years ago, came to Earth, lived, died, was buried. 3 days later, miraculously, came out of the grave and is alive today at the right hand of the Father praying for us. The resurrection is unique to Christianity. It is basic to Christianity. The resurrection of Jesus Christ was the most prominent part of the preaching of the apostles. And the book of Acts, which is the history of the early church, is filled with the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ. What do I mean by resurrection? I mean a physical, bodily resurrection. Jesus Christ, after being dead for 3 days, came out of the grave. Physically, bodily. It was him. He ministered for 40 days after that. And they knew him. He knew them. He ate with them. They touched him. He ministered to them. He prayed for them. It was the resurrection of Jesus Christ that changed the cowardly apostles into dynamic preachers. So I want us to look at this a little bit this morning. There are over 100 references in the New Testament to the resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ. I was amused at Charles Stanley this morning. Of course, they're on TV every Sunday, so they have to do things different. So they do resurrection or whatever the holiday is, they do it the Sunday before, so that then on Sunday the actual thing will be on TV. Of course, he's retired now, but the last time he preached, he did not do the resurrection on the Lord's Day Sunday. He said, "I know y'all were expecting a nice, smooth sermon on the resurrection of Jesus Christ." And he said, "I'm not going to do it. I'm going to do something else today, so I hope y'all are happy." And he's not one to do much humor, obviously, not on TV, but I thought that was kind of different, and he was bold enough to do that. But I do want to do the resurrection this morning, because it is basic, foundational, and fundamental to the Christian faith. And so my text is Romans chapter 15. I am going to begin in verse number 12 of Romans chapter 15, beginning in verse number 12 and going down through verse number 20. By the way, there was a controversy. There were preachers who had come into the Corinthian church after Paul left and preached that there was no resurrection, that there was no such thing. So Paul is answering the charge. Verse 12. "Now if Christ be preached that he rose from the dead, how say some among you that there is no resurrection of the dead?" We have that same crowd around today. We have the crowds around today that says, "Well, if you're dead, you're dead." That's not true. "But if there be no resurrection of the dead, then is Christ not risen? Since in the Bible it says he is the first And we come after that. If there's no resurrection, he didn't come out of the grave. And if he didn't come out of the grave, neither will believers. And if Christ be not risen, then our preaching is vain, and your faith is also vain. If there is no resurrection of the dead, the folks fishing this morning on the lake are in better shape than we are. Because if there's no resurrection, our faith is meaningless. He did something no one else ever did. Came out of the grave on his own. Yea, and we are found false witnesses of God. Everything I have ever preached here in the last 6 years is a lie if Jesus Christ didn't come out of the grave. Why? Because we have testified of God that he raised up Christ, which he did. But if he didn't, we're still dead, and he is not risen. For if the dead rise not, then is Christ not raised. And if Christ be not raised, your faith is vain, you are yet in your sins. The consequences of no bodily resurrection of the Son of God are earth-shaking to the 10th degree. Verse 18. Then they also which are fallen asleep in Christ are perished. How many times have I gone to the cemetery with loved ones in the last almost 60 years now and gave them the hope of a future resurrection that they would see their loved ones again? None of that would have been true if Christ didn't come out of the grave. Verse 19, if in this life only we have hope in Christ, we are of all men most miserable, because we have been living a lie. There's nothing true, and when life ends, that's it. And Paul puts this tinge of thought in there. If all there is to life is eat, drink, and be merry, and we missed all that and then don't have anything else, what fools we've been. But then that word in verse number 20, but now is Christ risen from the dead. I said in Sunday school, the Bible is a book of faith. We accept it by faith, God-given faith. Christianity came down from God to us. It is a religion of faith. The Bible is a book of faith. We accept it by faith in God. Faith is believing what God said and acting on it. And the Bible says Christ is risen from the dead. And one of the many, many benefits for us is and become the first fruits of them that slept. Now, the word sleep in the Bible only refers to the death of a Christian. Death is not a good word for the death of a Christian. It does fit more unbelievers, but not Christians. For a Christian, death describes, a sleep more describes our state after this life than death, because like sleep, you go to bed at night and you get up in the morning, and there is a glorious morning coming when the dead in Christ shall be raised. Now, let me address several things in view of that. First of all, we need to clarify a common theological error that has been going around for 2,000 years. It basically goes like this. Jesus didn't really die. He just fainted. The theological term for that is the swoon theory. It's false. It's not true. I want you to think about this. Let me give you several things. Jesus Christ appeared to the disciples after the third day, not as a weak, suffering, half-dead man, but as a conquering, triumphant victor over death and the grave. He could have never made the impression upon his disciples that he did had he presented himself in the picture of a sick, half-dead man. No, he arose supernaturally from the dead. Furthermore, we learn that when the soldiers pierced the side of Christ, there came forth blood and water. Physiologists and doctors agree that such a condition of the vital organs, including the heart itself, proves conclusively that death had taken place. Furthermore, Joseph of Arimathea asked permission to bury the body of Jesus because he knew that Jesus had been pronounced dead by the soldiers and the king. Furthermore, when the news was brought to Pilate that Christ had died, it said that, quote, Pilate marveled if he were already dead, and calling unto him the centurion, he asked him whether he had been any while dead, and when he knew it of the centurion, he gave the body to Joseph, Mark 15. Furthermore, the women brought spices to anoint a dead body, not a fainting living body. Furthermore, the soldiers pronounced him dead. It says, when they came to Jesus and saw that he was dead already, they brake not his legs, John 19. And finally, and conclusively, Jesus himself said that he was the truth, the way, and the life. And he said in Revelation 1:8, when he appeared to John, I am he that liveth, I was dead, and I am alive forevermore. Revelation 1:18. No, he didn't just faint. He didn't just give out under the pressure. He died. By the way, let me give you a spiritual reason he died. The law said the wages of sin is death. The law said the transgressor must die. Who are the transgressors? All of us. Every human being that ever lived. Jesus took my sin and your sin on him and died in our stead. Had he not died and taken our sins to the cross, we would still be bearing our sins. Amen. No, he died. Amen. And he came out of the grave. Therefore, we have an Easter message. Secondly, let me say a few things concerning a literal bodily resurrection. It was a real body, not a phantom, not a myth, not an allegory. It's a real body. It was made up of flesh and bone. He touched and could be touched, and he had the marks in that body. That resurrected body had the marks of his sufferings. But that resurrected body was more than just a natural body like you and I have. For example, he passed through doors. He passed physical limitations, moving from one place to another. He was not always recognized, especially by unbelievers. And it was a real physical body that ate with the apostles, that was taught by the apostles. When they went to the Mount of Olives, it was that real, literal, physical body that ascended into heaven. It was a real, immortal body that cannot die again. Amen. There is the matter of cause and effect. The effect of the cause is the resurrection. There is the empty tomb and the neatly folded grave clothes. There is now the Lord's Day. There is now the Christian church. There is now the New Testament. And thirdly, and most extensively, I want to talk to several groups of people this morning as to the result of the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ. The result of the resurrection as to Christ himself, the empty tomb clearly testifies to the deity of Jesus Christ. Did you know, when you go back to early 1 Corinthians, where we are in chapter 15, in that 40-day period that he was alive before he ascended, between the empty tomb and the ascension, there were over 500 eyewitnesses to the resurrection of Jesus Christ. I mean, how much proof do some people need? The empty tomb testifies to the deity of Jesus Christ. Peter, preaching, said to the group he was preaching to, it was impossible for the grave, death, to hold the Lord Jesus Christ. Acts 10:42. And now, the authority of his teaching is based on his resurrection. Matthew 28:6. I just take four words out of that verse, which says, risen as he said. You remember what we've been studying in Sunday school? What are the three most important words in the Bible? It is written. He is risen as he said. The result of that is what we see today in the Christian church and believers among a myriad of other things. Well, secondly, let me talk to believers. That would be the congregation. What are the results of the resurrection of Jesus Christ in your life and in my life? Well, it assures us of our acceptance with God. Our acceptance with God is not based on anything in us. It is based on everything in the Lord Jesus Christ. And if he, in even one area, did not do what he promised, we wouldn't have anything. It says in Romans 4:25, he was raised for our justification. The resurrection declares that God accepted what he did for us. It was the resurrection that guarantees our justification, which means declared righteous by God. It assures us of our acceptance with God. It assures us that Jesus is now at the right hand of the Father praying for us, Hebrews 7:25, whoever liveth to make intercession for us. It assures us of all needed power to live the Christian life and Christian service. Now unto him that's able to do exceedingly abundantly above all that we ask or think according to the power that worketh in us, unto him be glory in the church. If he had the power to come out of the grave and to do what he did and to say what he did, then he has everything that you and I need to live the Christian life. Did he not promise all power is given unto me in heaven? And then he said all power is given to me on earth. And then I would say, because of the resurrection of Jesus Christ, it assures us of our own resurrection. resurrection and immortality, when we go to the grave with loved ones to lay aside the body, the spirit is gone to be with the Lord, the body is put into the grave, it returns to dust. But the Bible talks about a great resurrection morning when Jesus Christ will come back in the air. The dead in Christ will be raised first, and we that are alive shall be caught up together with him in the air. None of that could happen if he's dead. None of it. He said in John 14, 19, because I live, ye shall live also. We have the guarantee that when we go to the cemetery with loved ones, that there will be a great day coming when Jesus Christ miraculously will be accepted by faith and no other way to please God. That because he did, we, his children, will also. There is a new order coming to planet Earth after this life, after this age, after the great tribulation, after the great wars, after the restoring of the Jews. We call it the millennium, a time when Jesus Christ will reign on earth and those with him who were his. And then I want to say a few words concerning the results of the resurrection of Jesus Christ to the world in general. 1 Corinthians 15:15-2 talks about the certainty of a resurrection even for unbelievers. Now, it's 1,000 years later than believers. Unbelievers will also live forever, just like believers, but in a totally different state. 1 Corinthians 15:52, as in Adam all die. That's what Adam did for us. Sin kills. The wages of sin is death. So it says, in Christ shall all be made alive. The just shall be raised to the resurrection of life. That's the rapture. The unjust shall be raised to the resurrection of damnation. There are two resurrections. There is unquestionably, because Jesus Christ came out of the grave and alive, there is unquestionably in the Bible declared a certainty of judgment for unbelievers. God hath appointed a day in the which he will judge the world. The resurrection of Jesus Christ declares it. Where is that judgment? If you want to turn there, it's in the book of Revelation, chapter number 20, verse number 11. And I saw a great white throne, and him that sat on it, from whose face the earth and the heavens fled away, and there was found no place for them. And I saw the dead, small and great, stand before God, and the books were opened, and another book was opened, which is the book of life. And the dead were judged out of those things which were written in the books according to their works. And the sea gave up the dead which were in it. And death and hell delivered up the dead which were in them. And they were judged, every man according to their deeds. And death and hell were cast into the lake of fire. This is the second death of unbelievers. And whosoever was not found written in the book of life, saved, was cast into the lake of fire. So there you have it. The absolute necessity of the resurrection of Jesus Christ. The absolute proof of the factual event of the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ. And the absolute proof of the benefits of the resurrection of Jesus Christ to those who serve and love him and are Christians, and the absolute judgment of unbelievers who deny Christ is God, who came, lived, died, was buried, and rose again. We call that the gospel. In 1 Corinthians, back to chapter number 15, it says, in the beginning of that chapter, 1 Corinthians chapter 15, Paul said, "Moreover, I declare unto you the gospel, good news, which are preached unto you, which also have you received, and wherein you stand, by which also ye are saved. If you keep in memory what I preached unto you, unless you have believed in vain. For I delivered unto you first of all that which I also received, how that Christ died for our sins according to the Scriptures, and that he was buried, and that he rose again the third day according to the Scriptures." What makes one a Christian? Nothing in you or me, other than we receive by faith what the Lord Jesus Christ has done for us. And our sins are removed on him, and his righteousness is credited to our account in Christ. In Christ, that's redemption. It's a spiritual thing. It's in here. And then as we begin to set out the Christian life, it works out to the benefit of others. It's called evangelism. We cannot underestimate, we cannot even put in adequate language the importance of the resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. Amen and amen. Would you stand, please? With every head bowed and every eye closed, we're glad to be able to again focus very specifically on the work of our Lord Jesus Christ for us. And the proof of the verity is he arose from the grave. It's a wonderful thing that we can think about that. But I don't want us to forget the fact that he didn't have to leave heaven and come to earth. He did that because he loves us. There's no explaining that. There's no comprehending that except by faith. Sometimes I wonder what would our lives be like without the Lord and the Bible? It would not be good. So, praise God, he did what he did. Perhaps you have never received it. Maybe this morning just something clicked and you have, the Holy Spirit has touched your heart. It's simple. Submit. 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 Receive him. Side in with him. Receive it by faith. If we can pray with you. In a minute we're going to sing. Come on forward. I'll pray with you. If there are other needs that I can pray with you about, come. May the Lord bless you. Our precious Heavenly Father, we bow before your throne. We acknowledge your Godhood. We receive your word. We thank you for this wonderful privilege that today, while in so many other places in the world, Christians can't even meet for fear of their life. Here in America, with all of our challenges, yet we can meet and worship and sing and pray and fellowship and praise you. Thank you, Lord. Lord, I ask you to make this precious to us and that we would be grateful for it and avail ourselves of it. Thank you, Lord. Now, Father, only you know hearts. So only you know who's saved and who isn't. Only you know who needs whatever that particular need may be. I ask you to meet that need. And Lord, I pray that you will be glorified and honored in our lives individually and this church together. Thank you, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. We're going to sing number
119.
Number 119. Sing with us.